We have a career close-up episode for you today. Hi, this is Shoptalk. I'm Ria Tanwat-Cotrillo. The world of fashion is constantly evolving, especially as young designers bring in their own brand of creativity and fashion sense to the industry. Today, we'll find out from guests how they were able to break into the fashion scene and what they're doing to build their names in this field. And of course, we'll get to see their designs. First up, we have with us Mel Orlina. Mel has been designing since 2006. Hello, Mel, and thanks for coming on the show.
Hi.
Okay, in college, you actually took up journalism.
Yes.
And you worked in advertising for many years. What precipitated this shift into the fashion industry?
Well, I've always loved fashion. Even when I was in college, I wanted to shift into clothing technology, but I was already in third year at the time. My mom wouldn't let me. So I promised myself that when I'm already earning money, I'm going to take courses on the side. And then, yeah, so...
So that's what you did. Where did you take your courses?
I took courses at Slim's and then again at LaSalle College of Fashion, and I took a year sabbatical in my job, in my advertising job, and went to London at Central Saint Martins.
Oh, you did! Yes. But that's where like everyone seems to want to go. That's like the place to go, right?
It's better to go to Central Saint Martins if you're just taking short courses or maybe month-long courses, because, well, number one, you don't have the language barrier. If you go to like a school in Italy or in Paris, there's still a little bit of you have to know the language. And Central Saint Martins, they have like a long list of courses, like, so whatever it is that you wanna pursue, like if you're not good at pattern, you take a 2-week course in pattern making and stuff like that. So you can combine your courses based on what you want and based on the field that you want to get into.
So you can tailor fit, so to speak, the courses
so
you take to your needs.
Yeah.
Right, okay. So was it very difficult to make that shift from advertising to fashion? Like, did you miss advertising, or did you come into fashion and say, this is so much fun?
Actually, I had advertising to thank it. Because they were very supportive. Because advertising is very, they're full of artsy people, so you kind of get influenced by them. So different styles, like some would be punky, some would be very, they're very, very supportive. And then, and I used to also sell my, the first things that I made to them. So they were my first customers.
Okay, so they were like your test market.
Yes.
If ever. Okay, when it comes to Mel Orlina's clothes, how would you describe your signature look?
It's very feminine talaga. I'm not, I don't do deconstructed, although syempre by request I can, but it's all very, my silhouette is very tailor fit, I think, to the Filipina, the Asian body, because we're smaller in stature, tapos we have shorter torsos. Mm-hmm. So I try to design around that kind of form. So it's very feminine, very modern.
Right. And, When you are designing, like, what kind of woman do you have in mind? I mean, I know, of course, you have the made-to-order stuff, so then you get to know your clients, but you also do have a line of ready-to-wear, right?
Yes. Well, I don't do collections per season. I'm like in Paris or France, we don't do I don't do stuff like that. So what I do is parang capsule collections lang. Like, for example, January to March is the prom season, so I kind of make my samples, my clothes that are very tailor fit to that kind of season. So weddings, if the wedding season comes in, so I do a lot of formals and stuff like that. And then of course there are like my RTW ready to wear. A lot of them are like shift dresses, very easy to wear semi-formal functions, stuff like that. And then I do champagne color stories based on a particular capsule collection.
Okay, what kind of materials do you like to use for your dresses?
Right now, my favorite is like a tulle jersey. It's a very thin matte jersey material fabric that stretches. So you can do tiny pleats. You can do, it drapes very beautifully, and the fall is very flattering because it doesn't have volume, so it really skims your body.
Right. Very, like, it's a very feminine material, right? Mm-hmm. So looking at some of the stuff you brought, I think that's the material you used, right? Am I right?
Yeah, the first one, the cream one. On
okay,
the right.
So that's the stretch tool.
Yes, that's a stretch tool.
That you use. Okay. And this is something that people can see at the window of your store.
Yes.
Right? Do you do, like, what do you enjoy doing the most? You like doing the ready-to-wear stuff, or you like doing the made-to-order, or you like doing bridal?
Can I say all? RTW, kasi, for me, it's kind of like a therapy. Eh? So I don't have a customer to think about. So it's just me. Like, I look at, when I wake up, I look at my closet, and if there's something missing in my closet, there's something that I want to wear but it's not in my closet, that's what I do for my ready-to-wear.
Okay, so that's where your creativity really comes out. Now looking at this beautiful fire engine red dress, it's also like got the ruching and the pleating thing going on. Is that a seasonal thing? I see it a lot now.
It's been around. I think the original designer who did the really tiny ruching design is Madame Gray. She's a 1930s Parisian designer, not as well known as like the Chanels and the Valentinos, but she pioneered that design, and I loved her for it. And I've been, ever since I started designing, she's been really, her designs are really my inspiration.
Yeah. And they're classic. If you're saying she started that method in the 1930s and we're wearing it in the 21st century, then it must be a good thing.
And she's if you look at her gowns in the 1930s, they're way better. I mean, like, her gowns are like, whoa, out there. So.
Right. Okay, so of course we mentioned bridal, and you've brought here a beautiful wedding gown, which hasn't been worn yet by your client.
Yes.
Okay. It's actually showing on Shoptalk before she actually wears it.
I asked her permission.
Down the aisle. Okay, maybe you can curate this whole ensemble for us.
Okay, this is, like she said, it's owned by a client, and she wanted something big and very feminine on her wedding day. So this is my design. This is what came out of it. Since the skirt is very detailed already with all the roses, we opted to have like slight beading, simple beading at the top. And because nowadays in churches, you can't wear chube.
Right.
You can't. So I designed like a removable thing on top. And
so that part is the sheer part. Okay, so she's covered up in church, when she gets to her reception, she can take it off, and then it's like a full-on bustier.
Yes.
Right. What are the usual requests you get from Filipinas when you make formal wear or even bridal wear for them?
Papayatin sila.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the number one thing that I always hear. They want to look thinner. They want to look thinner. So I kind of work around their body type. That's why draping works well. Because number one, you can position the draping to where the problem areas are. So if they're like big hip, you kind of drape it diagonally so that it will hide the hip area. Or if they have, or if they have a problem with their arms,
yes,
not a stone, you kind of drape it
as well
in a way so that becomes part of the design, and it doesn't look like you're trying to hide anything. So it has
it looks part of the fashion statement, right?
Yes.
Okay, and when it comes to the actual production, how do you manage that? Like, how big is your workforce, and do you have to be there, you know, like, making sure that the quality is controlled?
I have about 12 people working under me right now. 6 of them are sewers, 3 are beaders, and 1 is my production manager and a secretary to oversee everything. I'm very blessed because all of them are ladies.
Okay.
I don't, no men. So all of them are ladies. They're very masipag. I'm very blessed to have a very supportive workforce. But I always have to be there. I have to approve everything before it gets sewn. Final, before it gets assembled into a dress, I have to approve the look, the draping. I have to approve everything. So
okay, so everything still goes through.
Yes, of course.
So if somebody wanted to have an outfit or a dress made, how much lead time do you need?
Depending on our production schedules. Usually, if we're full, we need about 2 weeks. If we're not too full, I can do rush.
Oh, a lot of people like the rush, right? Yeah. Do you charge a premium though?
No, it's the same. It's the same. It's just that sometimes people are very busy and they can't help. They don't have time. So no charge.
Right. Okay. Wow, you're like a full service. You really like understand the needs of your clients. Okay, Mel, what's the price range of your RTW line and also for your bridal wear?
RTW, like bejeweled shift dresses or like something with detail, the average price is $4,500. Yeah, that's already made to order. We can do one for you. For cocktail dresses, it starts at $5,000 thereabouts, depending on the design and the material. For long gowns, $6,500. It's the starting price. It goes up only because of the material.
And the beadwork.
Beadwork and how long it will take to make. So I take that into account.
Right. And for bridal wear can be notoriously expensive these days. Like what are your packages?
For something like this, it's about $45 to $50
for that's just for the
gown.
For the
yes.
gown, right?
And if your wedding is just in the beach or a relaxed wedding, maybe $30 mm-hmm. With all the accessories. And if it's full lace and full embroidery, it can go as high as $60, but not higher than $65. So very affordable.
Right, you can work around the budget.
Yes, we have
which is very important. Okay, before we let you go, Mel, what is your advice to would-be designers?
I think they always have to remember that the business is a big part of it, because if you're bad at business, then you won't be a designer. You have no one to design to. And then also service. Because so first and foremost, even if it's an artistic field, you have to provide good service to your clients. You have to keep them, you have to make them happy. Although you can't please everybody, but you have to try your best. From the design to the final fitting to when they take. So you have to make sure that they're happy so that they come back to you.
That's right. Well said. Okay, Mel, Orlina, thank you so much
for talking
with us today.
Thank you.
All right. Well, we'll introduce you to another young designer after this break. Stay tuned. Shop Talk. We'll be right back.